This morning, you're very, very welcome as we start our service. I'm actually just going to take a wee seat here for a minute. We are actually starting our service this morning just with a wee quick video. So I'm nodding over to the AV team there, and I'm going to get out of the way and let you watch a wee video here to start. Okay, you are very welcome this morning. I'm just going to start by reading a psalm, Psalm 138, as we begin our service. So Psalm 138 is given the title, The Lord's Goodness to the Faithful. And it reads, I will praise you with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praises to you. I will worship towards your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above all your name. In the day when I cried out, you answered me and made me bold with strength in my soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, when they hear the words of your mouth. Yes, they shall sing of the ways of the Lord. For great is the glory of the Lord. Though the Lord is on high, yet he regards the lowly. But the proud he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you will revive me. You will stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand will save me. The Lord will perfect that which concerns me. Your mercy, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the works of your hands. And I just like what we read there in verse 6. Though the Lord is on high, yet he regards the lowly. And so this morning, as we meet together in Straid, in a little quiet village, in our wee church, In a lowly little place, the Lord who is on high meets with us and knows us and is here, and his presence is with us. And so we're going to stand together and sing as we praise and worship God, crown him with many crowns.
Thank you.
Okay, let's just open our service now in prayer. Let's talk to God. Heavenly Father, we meet together this morning, Lord, to give you praise and to give you our thanks, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that we can meet so easily together here. We thank you for such a beautiful morning. We thank you for the lovely sunshine that we've had this morning. And Lord, we're reminded just of creation and of your glory and of your power. And so, Lord, we thank you that we can even think there this morning, Lord, that while you are seated in heaven, Lord, seated in power and glory, Lord, that you remember the lowly, that you remember us. And so, Lord, we just pray that you will remember us this morning and that you will bless us for being here. Lord, we pray that you will bless us with your presence this morning. Lord, we thank you for your servant, Lord, as he brings your word to us this morning. But Lord, we pray that your word would be active this morning. Lord, we pray that you would be at work this morning, and we pray that you would meet with us, Lord. You know us all. You know our thoughts. You know what's in our hearts, Lord. You know everything about our lives. And so, Lord, you know exactly what we need this morning. And Lord, I just pray that you would meet with us, Lord, that you would speak into our hearts and challenge us with your word this morning, and that you would meet our needs, Lord, this morning. Wherever we are with you, Lord, wherever we are in our walk with you, that you would meet with us and challenge us and speak to us this morning, and that we would be able to leave here this morning knowing that we have met with you. Lord, we just pray for each person in our congregation, Lord, who has different challenging needs, Lord, this morning. We think of those who have lost loved ones. We think of those who are unwell and are waiting for tests and waiting for appointments and waiting for different things in hospital, Lord. And we just pray that you would be a comfort where it's needed this morning, that you would draw near, Lord, to those who are going through difficulties and going through scary times, Lord, that you would be a support and a comfort, Lord, that you would uphold those who need it. So, Lord, we just pray that you will bless us this morning with your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. So, folks, I'm very pleased to welcome Thomas Saunderson with us this morning. He's down on the announcement sheets as the Reverend Thomas Saunderson, and he wanted me to point out that he's not a reverend. He's just normal, he says. But he's here with us this morning, and he does look very normal. I'm very pleased to be able to pass over to him now. He's going to come up and do the children's talk, so I'm going to have a wee seat again. So, Thomas, thank you.
Thanks, Mike. Well, boys and girls, it's great to see you here this morning, to see you scattered all over the place. And I'm going to ask you a question or two, so don't be a bit afraid to shout out. If you're a low 99, shout out the answer if you know it. I have brought something with me here this morning. It's very useful at this time of the year because the clocks has changed and we would need it if we go outside at night. Does anybody know what it might be? Yes? A torch. I brought a torch with me this morning. Has anybody ever saw one of those? Al, are you one of those at home? That's good. There's only one thing wrong with my torch. It's not working. There's a wee problem with it. I'll switch it on. Would that be much use if I went out at night? No, that would be no use. Does any of you know what the problem might be? Yes? Batteries. Would you like to come up and put in a battery for me to see if it works? Aye, come on ahead. It's not easy, sure not. That's why I needed your help. Right, push it in now. Good job. Thank you so much. Right, that'll probably work now, will it? Still not working. Why would that be? Anybody any idea? Do you think it would need another battery? I will try another battery, right? Does anybody want to come up and put this one in? Come on, you head away from the back. Come on ahead. It's great, all these volunteers. You're loading down. Good man. Right, no, the other road. That's it. Brilliant job. That'll definitely go now. Still no use. What would the problem be now? We need one more. Any other buddy like to come up and put on a batter? I show you the green stripe top on. Good man. Let me see. I think this way here, maybe. Right. Hold on a wee minute. Try it now. Good job. Still not working. Ah, there were a wee flash there. There we are. We have power now. Why have we power? Because the battery is in the torch. And as I was thinking about coming to Straid this morning, the wee thought crossed my mind that we live in a dark and we live in a sinful world. And for boys and girls to be light in this world, well, they need power. But it's not the power of man, but they need the power of Jesus and their life to shine bright in this world. And how do we get the power of Jesus? Well, obviously we get the power of Jesus because we ask him into our heart as our own and personal Savior. And then we will have the light. Because the world is sinful, not only for boys and girls, but for each and every one of us in here today. The world is dark and the world is sinful. But you see, we need the full power of Jesus Christ because one battery wasn't enough. Nor two batteries wasn't enough. It took the three batteries to light up that little torch. So we need the full power of Jesus in our life that we can be effective in this sinful world that we live in. Because the world is just like night. When we go out, maybe the night at 7 o'clock, it's extremely dark, and we'll be stumbling about and we'll be falling. So we need the light to show us. And that's the way it is with Jesus. We need to know him as our own and personal Savior. And as we know him as our own and personal Savior, then he will show us by his Holy Spirit, by his light, where we will go and how he will lead us. And I'm going to ask the question, but I don't want anyone to answer it. But think very seriously, have you the power of Jesus in your life? As it were, have you the batteries of Jesus living in you each and every day? And then through Jesus you can see where you are going when you travel through this dark and sinful world. So the next time you see your dad or your mom or your grand or granny using a little torch, just remember, that little torch needs power the same way as you and I needs power of Jesus in our life. Thanks, mate.
So folks, I'm just going to run through a few announcements here before we sing our second hymn. The first one is just to let you know that Robin Cahoon's granda passed away yesterday morning. And so Robin and Hannah and Rory and the extended family are in our thoughts and prayers at this time, and the funeral's happening on Tuesday, so just remember them. Ballyfore Mission Hall are having a harvest service on Monday the 7th of November, that's tomorrow night at 8 o'clock, with the guest speaker, Pastor Joe Brown and Mrs. Heather Boyd singing at that. So if you're free tomorrow night, that's something you can go to. We have a letter here from the Newton Abbey Food Bank, who we have supported the last few years, really, at Christmas time. They're asking for donations, particularly of festive treats like schnoor, mince pies, Christmas puddings, biscuits, shortbread, chocolates, Pringles, selection boxes, and any other packaged food that would be able to last long enough. They're asking for all donations to be with them by Thursday, the 1st of December. Are we collecting here in church again, John? Is that? Don't know. Okay. Okay, so collections are available at Asda and somewhere in Lorne, but we're not sure where. We'll maybe try and get some more information on that. And then just announcements from our own church. Communion will be after the evening service this evening. And then looking ahead into the week ahead, we have Straid Ladies are having a board game night on Monday night. We have Mums and Tots at 10:30 on Tuesday morning. And then Bible study and prayer on Wednesday evening and morning prayer time on Thursday morning. And then Friday evening, we have junior and senior pathfinders at 7. And Straid Youth have an outing to Airtastic at 8:15 on Friday night. Next Sunday, our speaker is Mr. Johnny Farrell, morning and evening from Stand By Me. And then just one other bit of an update, really. You'll be aware that some people from church had a meeting with HED earlier in the week. And this is just a wee quick update on the HED meeting that we had. So I think there were maybe 5 or 6 of us were down the church on Wednesday morning with a lady from HED. And the meeting lasted for maybe just under an hour and a half. So it was a good long discussion that we had, and it was a useful meeting. We were able to get some useful information out of it. For example, we were given some clarity on the term about ecclesiastical exemption. That's a term that has been used lots in reference to the building project, and we've never really had someone who has been able to explain exactly what that term meant before. But this lady from HED was able to tell us that ecclesiastical exemption only applies if a church is looking to do something with its building that wouldn't normally require planning permission. But as soon as you look to do something that requires planning permission, then ecclesiastical exemption doesn't apply anymore, and so that doesn't really help us in our situation. It was made very clear to us during the meeting that HED were not going to be willing to support the plans that we had put in an application form. We had, as many of you will know, really tried to come up with a bit of a compromise plan, and the idea had been to keep the oldest part of the church, the old barn part of the church, and then hopefully demolish the rest to build the new sanctuary. The way this lady explained it was, once a building becomes listed, the whole building gets a red line around it, and at that point it becomes irrelevant which part is really old and which part is just a little bit old. HED want to preserve the whole building, and so for that reason they made it clear that they wouldn't support a plan which was going to try to demolish so much of the old building. She did, however, say that it was possible that HED could be overruled, and that having submitted plans we could find that the planning department are willing to overrule HED, and she said that was a possibility. And then she also took out her pen and was willing to draw a little bit on church plans and make some other suggestions about a different compromise that could possibly be reached, which HED might be in more support of. And we have been encouraged to do some drawings which are reflective of those suggestions that she made, and to send them to HED and get a little bit more of a formal response. So that's kind of where we're at with the building project at the minute. There is the possibility that things could be approved and HED could be overruled, but it's also worth at least investigating a slightly different compromise, and so drawings are being looked at the minute to be able to hopefully have some more information for you on that. So it was a useful meeting, a little frustrating at times, but it was a useful meeting to be able to get some of that information out of it. So we're going to stand together, we're going to sing our second hymn, and then I'm going to pass back over to Thomas. So thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to thank Mike for his kind words of welcome over here to Straid. It's a privilege to be with you to share a few simple thoughts from the Word of God this Lord's Day morning. If you have your Bible with you, we're going to turn to a familiar portion of Scripture, Luke chapter 7, and we're breaking in at verse number 11. Luke chapter 7, breaking in at verse number 11. And it came to pass the day after that he went into the city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and much people. Now when he came nigh to the gates of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and much people to the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said unto her, Weep not. And he came and touched the braid, and they that bare him stood still. And he said, Young man, I say unto thee, arise. And he that was dead sat up and began to speak, and he delivered him to his mother. And then came a fear on all, and they glorified God, saying, That is a great prophet is risen up amongst us, and that God has visited his people. And the remnant of him went forth throughout all Judea and throughout all the regions round about. And we know the Lord will add a blessing to his own inspired word. Let's just bow in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the words we have been singing this morning, leaning in the everlasting arms. And Father, those are the only arms that we can depend on. Father, we realize this morning everything else will fear, our only hope as in Jesus Christ. We pray you will come now as we look at your precious word. Father, we ask you will take away distracting thoughts from each and every one of us to focus on what you have to say to us this morning. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I heard a wee story one time of a fellow went to preach in a church for the first time, and he was a bit like myself, he was a bit nervous. But when he started to speak, when he had preached 10 minutes, a gentleman from the back row shouted, Hallelujah. And he thought to himself, well, I'm not getting on too bad here. There at least one person agrees with me. And he preached another 10 minutes, and the same gentleman shouted, Hallelujah again. And he says, I'm doing very well now. That's twice he shouted, Hallelujah. So he preached another 10 minutes. So that's half an hour, but don't worry, I'll not be as long as that. And the same gentleman shouted, Hallelujah again. So after the service was passed, the man who was preaching was standing at the door shaking hands, and he says to the gentleman, he says, I would like to thank you so much for your encouragement. He says, how did I encourage you? Well, he says, every 10 minutes you shout at Hallelujah. Oh, he says, I wasn't shouting Hallelujah. He says, I was shouting That'll Do You. So if I hear anybody shouting Hallelujah this morning, I hope it's not that I'll do you. If you're wanting a title for how I was going to try and say this morning, the title very simply would be, The Power of Christ Was Demonstrated. And only three times in Scripture we read that Jesus raised people from the dead. Of course, Lazarus was dead 4 days, and he raised Lazarus from the dead. Now, of course, Jairus' daughter, he also raised her from the dead. She just was dead. But now in the city of Nain, this man had just died that morning. And I'm sure every one of us can picture this in our mind's eye. As Jesus arrived to the city of Nain, this funeral was taking place. And this was a very sad occasion, because this was a widow woman, and this was her only son, and the son was dead. And I'm sure her hearts would go out to this lady. She was burying her only son, her only child. A very heartbreaking situation. But not only was it a heartbreaking situation because she had lost her son, but it was a heartbreaking situation because in those days there were no income for a widow, and the son was responsible for the income. So this lady now, she had no son, nor she had no income. And as the funeral was taking place, well, the mother was heartbroken. In those days, it wasn't a closed-in coffin the way we would see at a funeral. Nowadays, it was just a flat piece of board. And this young man was lying on this flat piece of board, and they were on their way to the graveyard, and this mother was breaking her heart. And friends, we would know what that is like, but Jesus had compassion in his heart for this lady, because we read there, what did he say to the lady? Well, he said there in verse 13, he says, "Weep not." And I'm sure this lady thought to herself, what's Jesus really saying? Or what's Jesus really talking about? I am heartbroken. And he's saying here, "Weep not." But friends, Jesus' heart was full of compassion. And I'm sure this woman, well, she marvels at that, those words that Jesus said when Jesus says, "Arise." And immediately, this young man sat up. And he didn't only sat up, but he began to talk. He began to speak. I want you to notice a few powers here. Well, first of all, I want you to notice the power of death in verse 12. Because this young man's life was over. This young man was dead. They were carrying him to the graveyard. And friends, that is a power that you and I have no control over. There are many things in life we have control over. But we have no control over our death. You see, it tells us in the Bible it's appointed unto man once to die. And friends, we will not escape that appointment. You see, during life we can change appointments if it doesn't suit us. But that is one appointment we cannot change. And the power of death had came and touched this family. The power of death had came and touched this young man. And friends, each and every one of us will have to go through the valley of the shadow of death unless Christ returns first. But I want to ask you a question. Have you made preparation when that day comes? In this life, we make much preparation. We're encouraged by the government to prepare when we get older to pay into a pension scheme. Or we maybe pay into a life insurance for our family. Or we maybe pay into a health plan. And those things are all right. We spend our life preparing. But have you prepared for that appointment of death? That appointment you cannot change. That appointment that you must keep. You see, a few years ago, I had an appointment on with the dentist one day. In my big head, I forgot all about it. I broke that appointment, and then they rang me the next day to tell me I broke the appointment, and very kindly, they charged me £30 for breaking that appointment. But you see, friends, the power of death, we will not break that appointment. Friends, in here today, I would encourage you, if you have no preparation made, make sure that you make preparation. But I want you to notice the power of death, it's universal. Because each and every one of us will have to die. You see, I was talking to a man a little while back, and he says to me, he says, "Tom, you know, I don't believe the Bible." And I says, "How can you not believe the Bible?" Well, he says, "Sure, it's just a lot of old fairy stories," is the way he put it. Well, I says, "How can you argue with the verse in Scripture when you're told it's appointed unto man once to die?" I says, "You cannot argue with that." I says, "Do you know any person or any neighbor that has not died in the times past?" He says, "No." I says, "You can't argue with the Word of God." You see, death affects each and every one of us. And when death comes and whispers in our ears, we will not put it off. Death is universal. But I want you to notice, this man was powerless against death. He was helpless against death. And if we study into this, we will find this young man, he was just in his teenage years. He was at his peak of strength. He was at his peak of being a strong man. But he was no enemy for death. And friends, it doesn't make any difference when we are young or we are old, when death comes, it takes us. And I have stood at many gravesides over my lifetime. The oldest lady was 101 years of age. But the youngest child was 1 week. You see, friends, when the power of death comes, we are helpless against the power of death. You see, the city of Nain, well, it was a lovely city. It was a rich city. But you see, it couldn't keep this young man alive. And when the power of death comes, we must go. Remember Naomi and her family when they went to the land of Moab, the land of plenty. Well, she lost her husband and she lost her two sons. And friends, every one of us in here today, I'm sure we have lost family members because of death. Friends, I lost a cousin a lot of years back, a young man of 22 years of age in tragic circumstances. You see, the power of death came one Sunday night. I was talking to him on Saturday night, and the plan was we would meet up in the beginning of the week. And the parting went something like this: I'll see you around in the beginning of the week. I'll give you a ring. But friends, do you know what happened? The power of death came. The Sunday night, it was an eternity. And friends, if that was anyone in Straid Congregational Church today, where would you spend that great eternity? You see, there will come a time when the doctors will say, I can do no more. There will come a time in each and every one of our lives. I remember my dad, he died with chronic lung disorder. And I remember that Friday evening, the doctor said to me and my three brothers, we can do no more. Before bedtime, it was an eternity. Friends, if the death angel came tonight, where would you spend eternity? You see, during life, we like to be in control of things, don't we? We like to have things planned. We like to be in control of our life. But friends, that's one thing we're never in control of, is death when it comes. The power of death. But I want you to notice, this young man here, the power of death came. And this young man was heading out of the city, as it were, on his last journey. But I want you to notice the power of love. Where do we see the power of love? Well, we see the power of love there in verse 13. Because we read here that his mother was weeping. And I believe the greatest power in this world is the mother's love. Because we have two young ones at home. And when they were children, when they fell and skint their knees, they never looked for me. They always looked for their mother. And this woman here, she was demonstrating love for her son. The greatest power that this world has. Friends in here today, there even a greater love near the love of a mother for a son. It's the love of the Son of God for you and for me. You see, Jesus went to the cross and he died for you and me. And we read that he wept in the Garden of Gethsemane as he done his Father's will. And friends, he went and he died on that cruel cross. Friends, it's a love the world never experienced before, nor the world never will experience again, the love of the Son of God. And this mother here, it was an undying love she had for her son. And friends, that points us to the cross of Calvary. Jesus had an undying love for you, and he had an undying love for me. But friends, of course, a love has to go two ways. I remember when I was a young person, and you maybe say you must have a good memory, but I remember when I was a young person, I ran about with a fella, and he went with a lovely girl, and they had went with her for a lot of years, and I thought there were going to be a marriage. I thought I would get a feed out of him someday. But that didn't happen. He took a notion, and he rung me one Friday afternoon, and he asked me if I was going to a certain place on a Friday night, and I said I was, and he says, I'll go with you. And I mentioned the name of his girlfriend. I says, well, what about her? Oh, he says, I finished with her last night. And I says, why on earth did you finish with her? He said she was a lovely girl. She probably would have made a lovely mother. But he said she loved me, but I didn't love her. And he says a one-sided love never can be. And friends, in here today, That's the way it is with Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ loves you, that he died on the cross for you. But friends, a one-sided love never can be. Friends, when we come to the point of death, Jesus still loves us. But when we stand before him, Jesus will still love us. But if we do not love him in return, he will reject us in that day. The power of love. Friends, do you know Jesus Christ this morning? Do you know him as your own and personal Savior? We're living in uncertain days. We're living in days of financial crisis. We're living in the days the government's a mess. A lady would spend more time in the supermarket than her government, her new government spent on number 10 Downing Street. But friends, in the midst of uncertainty, if you love Jesus, you have nothing to fear. Jesus is in control. The war in Iraq and Ukraine, or Russia and Ukraine, I should say. Friends, that's not a surprise to Jesus Christ. Friends, the financial crisis is not a surprise to Jesus Christ. Friends, in China at the minute, they're designing a new currency that they can track every penny that the people spend. Friends, that is not a surprise to the Savior, because we read about it. These things will come in the last days. That will be the beginning of the birth pains. Friends in here today, do you know the power of Jesus Christ in your life? The power of love. The love of the Savior. And us who are saved, us who know Jesus as our own and personal Savior, do we love the Savior as we ought to love him? Do we serve him as we ought to serve him? Do we spend time in the Word of God as we ought to spend time in the Word of God? Have we a desire for those who are lost? Have we a desire for those who are perishing? Do we love the souls of those who are not saved? Because friends, every one of us in here today has something in common. We have a precious soul that will live on for all eternity. Some people in the congregation this morning may be very rich. Some other people may be very gifted. But we have something in common. We have a precious soul. And Jesus loved it so much that he died for it. And friends, we are told in Ecclesiastes chapter 6, at the parting of death, there will be a great separation from the body and the soul. And the body will return to the dust of the earth where it came from, but the soul will go on to live in one of two places. And friends, if you don't love Jesus Christ as your own and personal Savior, the Bible tells us that you will go to a lost eternity, what the Bible describes as hell. Friends, what an awful place. But if you love Jesus at the parting of death, the time of death, our soul will go to be in the presence of the Savior. But friends, we must love him. Do you love Jesus today more than you love anything else? And friends, dare I ask that question? Do I love the Savior as I ought to love him? You see, we love our families. We love our wife. We love our children. But do we love the Savior? Do we know Jesus intimately as we ought to know him, us who are saved? Do we desire to come to the place of worship? Have we the desire to attend the place of prayer? I know my own church, the worst attended meeting is the prayer meeting. Friends, it's the same faithful few. Friends, I don't know anything about Straid Congregational Church. But friends, we need to love the Savior. Friends, Jesus loved us. Do we love him in return? But I want you to notice the power of tears. In verse 13 again, he said to this woman, "Weep not." Jesus was moved with compassion. Jesus wept at the grave of Lazarus. Do you remember how Jesus wept over Jerusalem? When he said to Jerusalem, "As a hen gathers her chicks, but ye would not come." Friends, Jesus was moved with compassion. I remember a few years ago, I had a little boy, well, he's 20 now. He kept a few hens or a few chicks. And there were one of those chicks, or one of those hens had a brood of chicks, and we let them out one morning, and there's a valley down where I live, and there were a peric and falcon flying up and down the valley. And the hen saw the danger. And you know, from a farming community, the clucking sound they make to warn the little chicks there were danger. Well, out of those 9 little chicks, there were 8 of them flew in under the mother's wing to the place where they were safe. But there were one that didn't listen. And of course, you know how the story ends. The peric and falcon flew down and just picked it up in its claws and flew away with it. My wee boy shouted and screamed at the peric and falcon, but it was gone. You see, friends, it didn't listen to the warning. You see, friends, the people in Jerusalem, they didn't listen to the warning. Friends, there are power in tears. This woman was moved with compassion. Friends, we are told, those who sow in tears will reap in joy. Those that go forth weeping will bring forth precious shields with them. The great preacher, the great Robert Murray McShane, sad to say, he died at the young age of 30. And at his funeral service that day, his congregation was there. There were a lot of strangers there, and they asked one of his congregation, "How did Robert Murray McShane preach?" He says he preached in tears for lost souls. Friends, that's a challenge for us who preach. How many times have I, as a preacher, have preached in tears for the souls of men and women who are lost? You see, Jesus, he cried with compassion. But I want you to notice the power of prayer. I'm sure this woman had prayed for her son, but the answers of her prayer, well, they were delayed. This young man, he was dead. But friends, if this young man had not died, the power of Jesus Christ wouldn't have been demonstrated that day at the funeral. Because if this young man would have been able to get up out of his coffin before Jesus would have appeared, well, the crowd would have said, well, sure, he was going to get better anyway. We see here that Jesus' plans was perfect. Jesus' power was demonstrated to the people who gathered round that day. And sometimes we have prayed for a loved one for years. I have a brother who is not saved. I prayed for him for many, many years. But Jesus has delayed answering that prayer to this point. Friends, Jesus does things his own way to bring him the most glory. You see, the prayers was answered. We see the power of Jesus Christ at work here. We see the change in this young man's life. This young man was dead. He could do nothing for himself, but he responded to the call of Jesus Christ. Because what do we read? Well, when Jesus called this young man, he responded because he sat up. I want to ask you a question. How many times has Jesus Christ called you? Have you responded to the call? As it were, have you sat up? Maybe you're a father or a mother in here. Your son or daughter has prayed for you for years. Maybe you're a son or daughter in here. Your father or mother has prayed for you for many, many years. Have you responded to the call of Jesus Christ? You see, if this young man hadn't responded, Jesus was passing by. Jesus wasn't returning again. The funeral would have been over. This young man would have been dead. Friends, you and I, if you're not saved, you're dead in your trespasses and sin. Jesus may be calling you today. But friends, the Spirit of God will not always strive with man. Will you respond to the call today? People maybe has prayed for you for years. You see, when I was a young boy, I had a godly mother. I was the youngest of four boys, and I'll assure you, we were no angels. But I remember a mother, when her husband went to work, the other three boys was away to secondary school, I still was at primary school. And I heard a mother cry each and every morning for a lost husband and four lost sons. Friends, she cried. She wept in tears. Friends, she lived to see some of those prayers answered. There's two other brothers saved. I was saved. My father got saved before he died. Friends, there's power in prayer. You see, the prayer was answered. This young man here, he sat up. But we see the change in this young man's life. Because, well, when he was dead, obviously, he could do nothing for himself. He couldn't speak. But he sat up and he began to speak. What a witness he was to that community. But I want you to notice the power of Christ. The only person who could help this young man was Christ. In verse 14, we read there, I say unto ye, arise. Friends, this was a hopeless situation. This was a hopeless case. There no one else could help this young man except Jesus Christ. And friends, anyone who is dead spiritually, the only one who could help is Jesus Christ. Friends, I want to ask you a question. What will your response be if you're unsaved? You see, Jesus is the only one who can save. Jesus was the only one who could bring this young man new life. And friends, there were evidence of his new life here because he began to speak. You see, the power of Christ was demonstrated here. And I'm sure the crowd stood in amazement because we read that they stood in amazement, glorifying God. Because his power was demonstrated in this young man. What a change for this young man. I'm sure his mother never thought when he was heading to the graveyard that he would be coming back home with her. Why? Because through the power of Jesus Christ it raised him from the dead. Friends, I want to also ask us who are saved and ask myself this question first. Friends, are we a living witness to Christ Jesus in our life? As I go to my place of work tomorrow, there are roughly 50 men works there. Very few Christians. Am I a living witness that I have been with Jesus? That Jesus gave me new life through him? Because if I am not, shame on me. Friends, the power of Christ was demonstrated that day. That young man arose. That young man cast behind him, as it were, the grave clothes that day. That young man hadn't to be carried with the people who were carrying him because he had met with Jesus Christ. Friends, I want to ask you a question. And ask you this question in love. Have you met with the Savior? Have you responded to his call? Are you willing to leave the deadness of sin behind? Friends, as a congregation, I would encourage you to pray for those little children who went out earlier. Because we are living in a sinful and dark world. A few weeks ago, I got a call from a distressed father. One Saturday night at 4 o'clock, his son had never arrived home. He says, "Tom, would you go with me to help me look for my son?" I says, "I will." So I went round to his house, and me and him would get into the car, and we headed to the nightclub where that young man was going that night. We got to the nightclub, it was almost 5 o'clock. He was gone, there were nobody there, the nightclub was dead. We headed back home, and I said, "Who was he going with?" And he said, so we headed to that home. There the car was sitting at the bottom of the lane. And we get out with the torch, and we shone a light in. There his son was lying under the influence of drugs. His friends had left him. Friends, that's what our young people is up against today. Friends, that's called the pleasures of the world. But the Bible describes it as sin. Friends, we get that young man out of the car. We get him carried to his father's car. And friends, it would have broke your heart. I mean, none young man couldn't even stand. Friends, looking for satisfaction. Friends, that's what Satan does. Friends, pray for those children. You Christian parents in here today, pray for your young children before they get into the things of this sinful world. The power of Jesus Christ was demonstrated. The power of death, we cannot pull off that appointment. The power of love. The mother loved this young man. The power of tears. The mother was heartbroken. The power of prayer was answered. And the power of Christ was demonstrated. Friends in here this morning, as we leave this church building in a few minutes' time, if we are saved, make sure the power of Christ demonstrated in my life and your life. Make sure that we pray. And friends, if you're not saved this morning, I say this lovingly and I say this graciously. Make sure that you receive new life before you go out onto the street and Straid here this morning. The power of Christ was demonstrated. Thanks so much for listening. Let's pray. Father, we ask that you will take these few simple thoughts and you will convey them to each and every one of our hearts. And here today, Lord, we realize their power in Christ, their power and prayer. We ask these things in the Savior's name. Amen. We're going to close our service by singing the words before the throne of God above. I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, who ever lives and pleads for me. Standing to sing, please.
Thank you.
Father, we want to thank you that our souls has been purchased with your blood. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God, and the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you today and forevermore. Amen.